Hello, and welcome to a Compute 301 virtual lecture. This is by me, Abram Hindle. And I'll be giving you this lecture from the comfort of my computer while I'm outdoors. All right, this lecture is on UML sequence diagrams. Essentially, these UML diagrams, these sequence diagrams, represent the behavior between objects, represent behavior as interactions. So the interactions are basically messages passed between objects. These messages might be actions or they might be method calls, but in essence, in O analysis and design, messages are basically method calls called on objects. All right? So first off, we start with a problem. We've got a watch user who has a watch and he wants to set the time on it. This watch has an LCD display in which he can set the time. Notice how the watch user is represented by a stick figure with the object name watch user. There's a colon under and an underline watch user. That means he's an object, he's an instance, and he's an actor. So this is a real person. The entire task of setting the time is represented by this one giant activation, which is the entire task the user calls upon. Then each object has its own sort of timeline where it exists. Each object has a lifeline that falls down from itself. This is how long the object is alive during this current interaction. Notice how all four of these objects and actors are basically existing throughout the entire interaction. All right, so we've got this one task that the user is trying to change the time. This task consists of the user sending multiple messages to the watch, but the user never sends anything directly to the LCD display or to time. Okay. So the first thing the user does to change the time on a watch, especially the minutes, is to press the button 1. Alright? So they press button 1, and it blinks the hours. The watch receives the press button 1 message, and then delegates, see this activation, it's code, right? It's delegating to the LCD display. The LCD display is then going to blink the hours for us. Then the watch user wants to do the minutes, so he presses button 1 again, and blink minutes is then sent off to LCD display from the watch. So the user sends a message to watch, press button 1, watch sends a message to LCD display, blink minutes. Now the user presses button 2 in order to actually change the time. This causes the watch to increment minutes, so it sends a message to time, this time object, it says increment minutes. Minutes will change in the time object, and then it will call refresh on anyone listening to its events. So it calls refresh to LCD display, and LCD display will probably now display the current change. All right. Then we press button sound 2, and then this will commit the time. So we tell time, okay, we've now committed, so you can start going on with that. And then the watch will tell the LCD display to stop blinking altogether, right? So what's important here? We've got activations, which are basically the time it takes for the method to run. We've got messages that are sent from an activation. We've got even return calls. See, this isn't a return value, this is a call. It's a call from time to display. These arrows indicate the direction of the call. The lifeline indicates that the objects exist at the same time. The boxes indicate their objects. The colons indicate the class of that object. Okay? So, we try to show the interaction. And we can use this in object-oriented analysis. We can do this during the requirements analysis stage in order to refine the use case descriptions, to find additional objects, find participating objects, and see how they actually work together. We can use this during design to basically refine the subsystem interface and make sure we're not exposing things unnecessarily. It's important to recognize that classes are represented by these columns, and the messages are basically represented by arrows. They're method calls being called from one class to another, from one object to another. And the activations, the methods themselves, as they're running, are being represented by narrow rectangles. Lifelines are represented by dashed lines. Okay? One important thing about the sequence diagram is the nesting of methods. Of messages. It's meant to show you that your one message can go off and cause the delegation to other objects and method calls to other objects. Furthermore, it can show the data flow. When I press the zone button, when I send the select zone to the zone button, The zone button will go to the tariff schedule and look up the price based on my selection. It will return the price to the zone button. This price then can be used to display to the display. So the tariff schedule doesn't have to talk to the display. The zone button will talk to the display and it delegates there. But this dashed arrow indicates a return value. So the source of the arrow indicates the activation from which the message was sent. So the passenger here, this activation is sending a message. An activation is as long as all the nested activations. Notice as this activation covers, in terms of space, both of these. So, oops. Sorry. Anyways, so see from here to here, all this stuff is covered, right? All this stuff is covered. It's all within this activation. The horizontal dashed arrows indicates data flow. The vertical dashed lines indicate lifelines, okay? Now, that's all fine and good, but oftentimes we have to do a task more than once. So you can imagine in the case of change processing, we might have to insert many coins, but we don't want to draw the case of 1 coin, 2 coin, 10 coin, 17 coins. So we've used this star here. See the star as an iteration, as something indicates iteration. So we're going to do this more than once. So then when we insert a coin, we look up the coin identifier returns the price. Notice how this isn't a call, this is a return. And then it can display the amount. Well, if the amount is not zero, right, we're going to have to say give change back. So there's a chance that if the amount is less than zero, that we're going to have to return change in the owed amount. The coin drop can then return the change, we can delegate to that. But the point is that we've got this conditional here. You see this red stuff highlighted? These square braces indicate a Boolean expression, and that's the condition, right? So we can do iteration with the star right there, and we can do conditions, okay? Now, creation and destruction. Oftentimes, objects are created and destroyed. For instance, a virtual ticket, after it's printed, is no longer needed. The printed ticket now exists, so we'd probably have a printed ticket class if it was important. Anyways, so in this change processor, when it creates a ticket, it prints it and then it frees it. When we don't need this ticket anymore, we can destroy it. So if it's going to be garbage collected, we can use this X mark to indicate we're going to garbage collect it and it's destroyed. All right? So the lifeline indicates when it's built. We can actually do creation simply by pointing at the object itself. See how this object is made? Yeah. So, sequence diagram summary. UML sequence diagrams represent behavior in terms of interactions. They provide a runtime view of how objects interact. They also are useful for finding missing objects during analysis. They're time-consuming to build, but a runtime view is often worth the investment so we understand how these classes fit together. Furthermore, they complement class diagrams, which represent structure, by providing a runtime view of how these things work together. They're good during analysis and design. All right, thanks.